Click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ekeeda.
Hello friends, in last lecture we have seen the differences between the straight beams and the curved beams and how the strains vary in both of them. In today's lecture, we are going to look at the assumptions which are made while doing the analysis of curved beams. So let us start with it. Like we had seen, the assumptions which were made in the analysis of straight beams, similar considerations we are going to make in the analysis of curved beams. So very first thing is, it should be a pure bending. In short, the beam, the curved beam, is assumed to be under the impression of only pure bending. There is no torsion, there is no axial force acting directly on the beam. Why these considerations are important, guys? The analysis which is based on these assumptions, the same formula we have derived for that particular analysis. So, using these assumptions only, we have derived the formula. Of course, we are in the superficial level of the design subject. As we advance in between, we'll learn the higher version of this. So, as of now, we will assume that the beam is under impression of only pure bending. Let's move ahead with the second assumption. The second assumption is quite general, which we make always. It's all about the material. We'll assume that the material is isotropic and homogeneous in all directions or throughout its body. As we know that material is going to be isotropic, its properties are also going to be isotropic. So in all directions, when we are going to analyze it, the results are going to be quite perfect. Let's move on to the third assumption. If you remember a similar assumption we had made in the analysis of straight beams, they are called, the plane will be perpendicular to the axis. If you assume the length of a beam, let us assume that it is made up of n number of planes. Yes, even after their bending, the planes will always look normal to the axis through which they are passing, right? So this assumption is very important because we are not considering any distortion that is happening inside the beam. We are considering that whatever distortion, whatever deflection is happening in case of beam, that is going to be uniform right from the first end of the beam up to the second end of the beam. And that's why this third assumption is very important. The next assumption is all about stress value. It is assumed that the stress value or the maximum stress value that is inducing inside the body will not exceed the elastic limit of that particular material. Guys, we know that when a body or when material, the stress induced in that material exceeds its elastic value, the material switches into plastic zone. So we are not considering any plastic analysis, we are considering only elastic analysis, and that's why we'll assume that the material property or the maximum stress induced in the material will remain in the elastic limit. So I'll say sigma maximum will be smaller than or equal to elastic limit of that particular material. The next assumption is, now again, if there is a beam, like we had said, it is made up of n number of planes, we can assume that it is made up of n number of planes in this manner also, or we'll call them layers to distinguish. This will be the planes vertical and this horizontal will be the layers. So let us assume that all the layers are in the vertical manner. So when the curved beam is concerned, we have assumed that all the curved layers are free to expand on their own. That means the layers, after application of load, will expand in the same manner. They'll not expand differently because that will induce again shear loading inside, in between them, right? That's why expansion will happen altogether. So the next one is, expansion of layers will happen in the free manner. To illustrate this point, the perpendicular stresses and this, I'll draw it quickly. If I assume the beam is made up of this kind of planes, so they all are in this manner. So these all are planes. Whereas, if I consider that the beam is made up of layers, they are called layers. So that is how it is related with this, and this is related with this particular point. Let's move on to the last assumption. We know that Young's modulus is very important property for a material. And why it is important? Because it decides the way the material expands or the way the maximum stress is induced inside a material. So it is assumed that the Young's modulus will remain constant for both tensile and compressive state of the curved beam. Young's modulus, which is denoted by letter E, capital E, remains same for tension and compression. So why this assumption is important? With this particular assumption, we can generalize the formulae for both tension and compression. Otherwise, we will have to derive them separately and it will be a difficult task. We are learning this topic little superficially as of now. As we dig into the topic, we will go into details of how the stress variations happen. So that was from my side, guys. If you like this video, please subscribe to Ekeeda. Thank you so much for watching the video.